Author E.L. Doctorow once wrote, "I can assure you Ernest Hemingway was wrong when he said modern American literature began with Huckleberry Finn. It begins with Moby Dick, the book that swallowed European civilization whole." In this series, we will present a summary and explore the themes of arguably the greatest novel ever written, Moby Dick. This first lecture will focus on chapters 1 through 3. Chapter 1 is titled Loomings, and it begins with the most famous opening line in literature, "Call me Ishmael." Ishmael is the narrator of the novel, and he promises to recount the tale of a whaling voyage that he went on several years ago. The first chapter introduces the main philosophical themes of the novel. One such theme is free will. Ishmael does not believe that free will exists. He concludes that fate compelled him to go on the whaling voyage, that it was his destiny. He writes, "Doubtless, my going on this whaling voyage formed part of that grand program of providence that was drawn up a long time ago. I think I can see a little into the springs and motives which, being cunningly presented to me under various disguises, induced me to set about performing the part I did, besides cajoling me into the delusion that it was a choice resulting from my own unbiased free will and discriminating judgment." Ishmael also discusses the symbolism of the ocean and the land. The land is solid and bounded, very much like a prison. Describing the people he sees walking along the shores of the island of Manhattan, Ishmael states, "These are all landsmen, of weekdays pent up in lath and plaster, tied to counters, nailed to benches, clinched to desks." The ocean, on the other hand, is unbounded and mysterious. It symbolizes the ungraspable meaning and truth of the cosmos. Ishmael reflects, "Why upon your first voyage as a passenger did you yourself feel such a mystical vibration when first told that you and your ship were now out of sight of land? Why did the old Persians hold the sea holy? Why did the Greeks give it a separate deity and own brother of Jove? Surely all this is not without meaning, and still deeper the meaning of that story of Narcissus, who, because he could not grasp the tormenting mild image he saw on the fountain, plunged into it and was drowned. But that same image we ourselves see in all rivers and oceans. It is the image of the ungraspable phantom of life, and this is the key to it all." Chapter 2 is titled The Carpet Bag. In this chapter, the story of the whaling voyage begins. Ishmael wanders about the town of New Bedford in search of lodgings for the night. It is a cold December evening, and Ishmael thinks about the poor souls who cannot afford shelter from the harsh elements. Poor Lazarus there, chattering his teeth against the curbstone for his pillow, and shaking off his tatters with his shiverings. What thinks Lazarus? Can he warm his blue hands by holding them up to the grand northern lights? Would not Lazarus rather be in Sumatra than here? Would he not far rather lay him down lengthwise along the line of the equator? Yea, ye gods, go down to the fiery pit itself in order to keep out this frost. Eventually, Ishmael walks into the Spouter Inn, which is the title of Chapter 3. Upon entering the inn, Ishmael notices an oil painting which is hanging on a wall. The painting itself is obscure, and it is difficult to determine the precise meaning of the image. Yet was there a sort of indefinite, half-attained, unimaginable sublimity about it that fairly froze you to it, till you involuntarily took an oath with yourself to find out what that marvelous painting meant. Ever and anon, a bright but alas deceptive idea would dart you through. It's the Black Sea in a midnight gale. It's the unnatural combat of the four primal elements. It's a blasted heath. It's a hyperborean winter scene. It's the breaking up of the ice-bound stream of time. But at last all these fancies yielded to that one portentous something in the picture's midst. That once found out, and all the rest were plain. Ishmael's attempt to deduce the meaning of the painting is analogous to the reader's attempt to deduce the meaning of the novel and its many symbols. On a cosmological scale, it is analogous to man's search for meaning in life. Like Ishmael, who has difficulty interpreting the meaning of the oil painting, we have difficulty determining the meaning of life. We often arrive at unsatisfactory answers, but we continue the search nevertheless, because there is a sort of sublimity that freezes us and compels us to seek understanding. At the Spouter Inn, Ishmael rents a room for the night. The landlord tells him that he will be sharing a bed with a harpooner named Queequeg, who is currently trying to sell one of his shrunken heads in town. At first, Ishmael is naturally apprehensive about the prospect of sharing a bed with Queequeg, but he reasons, "What's all this fuss I've been making about?" thought I to myself. "The man's a human being just as I am. He has just as much reason to fear me as I have to be afraid of him. Better sleep with a sober cannibal than a drunken Christian." Ishmael's openness to different religions and different cultures is consistent with the idea that there is no one right way of living. Just as the oil painting has many different interpretations, but no right one, so too are there many different ways of living, but no one right way of living. Don't forget to subscribe and join us for the next lecture on Moby Dick.